Welcome again. We will now be connected with Jesus Hernandez Galan and Katarina Ivankovic Knezevic. And I don't know if they're on, but I hope they're on. So let me introduce you, Jesus Hernandez Galan. He is a PhD engineer with an outstanding qualification cum laude. He has more than 30 years working in innovation and accessibility, leading diverse teams experience, and from 2000 to 2003 as general director and CEO of the Via Libre consultancy. At the end of 2022, he was appointed director of the European Accessibility Center, an activity that he combines with his current job as director of accessibility and innovation at the Ombudsperson Foundation, a position he has held since 2003. His training includes IESE, PDG, and Senior Management Program for Research, Innovation and Technology Transfer Institutions, Stanford University, London School of Economics, and he is an expert in business management and innovation. He is also a professional coach, a professor, and speaker. He is currently Vice President of the European Network for Accessibility Tourism, ENAT, and President of the Technical Committee for Standardization 170. Universal Accessibility and Design for All. He is patron of several foundations and member of the board of directors of Union Hotels and member of the advisory board of the startup Milesy Bionics. He has participated as director or member of the jury in more than 10 doctoral theses and in more than 80 publications and articles, and he has lectured in more than 30 countries. So, thank you so much for welcoming Jesus.
Thank you very much. First of all, congratulations to the Fellow Project. Thank you for co-organizing this first European level event workshop of the AccessibleEU Center. And congratulations to the Fellow Project because this is one of the biggest, maybe the best event focus on disabled and accessibility, disabled persons and accessibility. I would like to ask you if you know what is AccessibleEU. You know what is AccessibleEU because all of you are there, but maybe there are persons that don't know yet what is AccessibleEU. I think we can conceptualize AccessibleEU Center as a knowledge hub. It's an initiative of the European Commission, and the European Commission knows there are a lot of information, but it's disseminated in the different countries. So one of the purposes of AccessibleEU Center is collect, produce, and disseminate knowledge and information and create a platform, a one-stop shop to collect and to concentrate the main and the most important information and libraries, good practices, books on accessibility. The other problem that the Commission detects is there are not enough professionals on accessibility. For that, one of the purposes, the objectives, the goals of AccessibleEU is train professionals. And this is a problem that we have. We're still having in our universities because the training, the education and accessibility is not enough yet. Actually, there are architects, professionals, ICT, software developers that don't learn any about accessibility in their university and high education studies. So for that, it is one of the objectives of AccessibleEU, train professionals. And the other goal is help countries to implement the accessibility legislation. We have now at the European level some different legislation on accessibility, and it must be adopted in the different countries. So the AccessibleEU Center help to the countries to implement this legislation. What pillars is working on AccessibleEU Center? It's an holistic approach. AccessibleEU Center works on universal design, within design services and transport. What organization running the center, as I said, is an initiative of the European Commission, is one of the flagships of the strategy of the rights of persons with disabilities in Europe, but the consortium we're running in this center, managing this center, is led by Fundación ONCE. It's one of the biggest organizations of persons with disabilities in Europe and in the world, and with the, I think, the most experienced organization on the different pillars on accessibility in Europe. For example, the European Network for Accessible Tourism is the responsible and the senior expert on built environment, the Johannes Kepler University of Linz on ICT, the EASPD on policies, and on standardization, UNIT, the standardization body organization on of Spain, Spanish organization of standards. The main activities, one of the main activities is the communication activities. As I said at the beginning of my speech, one of the objectives is disseminate knowledge and information. For those, the communication activities is one of the most important tasks in our daily activities. We create a platform, a web. We disseminate one newsletter every two months, and we use the social nest to disseminate the information of AccessibleEU. We collect information, as I said before. We create one online library. Our goals for last year, for 2023, was collect 60 library references, and we collect last year 173 library references. So we multiply per three now our goal of last year. And regarding good practices, our goal was last year to collect in different countries, five per country, 135 good practices. And now we have in the platform almost 200 good practices. The other activity is awareness raising activities. The European Commission know that there is a lack of awareness about the accessibility in the different stakeholders, mainly in universities and in the industry, public administration, but mainly in the industry and the universities. So, and in the professionals of accessibility, professional, for example, architects or professional of informatics. For that, we are focused to increase the awareness of accessibility of the stakeholders, and the activities that we are producing, developing, is mainly events to award this knowledge about accessibility. We have to build a community about accessibility. We are organizing networking events, and we have a community of practices. We have a LinkedIn group, and there is our community of practices. Our objective last year was get 500 members of our community of practices, but last year we get more than 1,700 today. We have 1,800 members in this community of practices. We produce contents and knowledge. Last year, we produced 6 guidelines in the different topics, in the different pillars of the AccessibleEU Center on transport, on built environment, on ICT and policies, and legislation and standards. And this year we are going to work on different topics to produce knowledge about cognitive accessibility, about the accessibility on the European Bauhaus. We are close to this initiative of the European Commission, the European Bauhaus, and focus on the higher education. As I said, it's important to aware and to facilitate and provide to the universities material to incorporate the curricula, on the curriculum, the accessibility questions, the accessibility knowledge. We are going to produce a working together with Digital Europe. It's the umbrella of the organization and the companies of the digital industry, the technological industry. The topic for this year is artificial intelligence. Last year, we worked on the multimodality and how the multimodality enhances the capabilities of the persons with disabilities. Other main goal is increase the number of accessibility professionals. How we do that? Training, organizing workshops, bench learning events, training and mutual learning events. Today, we are in the first workshop now in the Zero project. It's a workshop about legislation. And on May, we are going to organize a workshop with the European Association of Number of Emergencies, when 112 companies and organizations who manage these services to how to manage emergency calls according to the European Accessibility Act, and how these services can attend the necessities of the persons with disabilities. We create a pool of indicators to monitorize the accessibility on the different countries to know the reality of the accessibility in the 27 countries, and we support the standardization. In figures, AccessibleEU, last year we organized 90 events. Our goal was 88, and we participated in over 74 events. We participate in speeches in different events. We get more than 15,000 attendees in our events. The objective was 9,220 attendees in the different events, in the 28 events. We collected 368 documents. The goal was 195, so we multiplied per two this goal, and we produced 7 new documents this last year. I am going to, I am finishing now, saying that we have in front of us 3 years more to work on AccessibleEU, to disseminate the knowledge and to increase the awareness on accessibility in the different countries. I am sure at the end of this period, this 4 years of project, we are going to have one Europe more inclusive, more accessible for all of us. Thank you very much for attending.
You mentioned the indicators. Can you tell us a little more about your indicators that you have implemented for the different countries?
Yeah, is it not easy to have a common pool of indicators in the different countries, all the countries, the same indicators, because the reality in the 27 countries is different, the reality of accessibility. So we work last year in 2023, focus on the quality, because get the information for accomplish the indicators. Focus on quantity is not quite easy. So for that, we have a pool of these indicators following the different legislation that we have at the European level to know which is the reality, the process was we created, we proposed these indicators. It was analyzed by the national experts, because I haven't mentioned that we have 34 experts in the 27 countries, experts on accessibility. They are the members and the representatives of AccessibleEU in each country. They analyze this proposal of indicators. It was approved by the Commission, and we collect information. In the next coming days, we will have in the platform, in our web, the results of these indicators.
So thank you again, Jesus, for joining us today, and saludos a Madrid.
Muchísimas gracias.
So our next guest is Katarina Ivankovic-Knezevich, and I'm very pleased that she will join us also online. She is the Director of Social Affairs and in the Directorate General for Employment, Social Affairs and Inclusion. And since September 2018, she's a Director for Social Affairs. Her area of activity is modernization of social protection systems and wider social policies, fostering social and labour market inclusion through the implementation of the European Pillar of Social Rights and other relevant social policies of the European Union. Before the European Commission, she was a State Secretary in the Ministry of Labour and the Pension System of the Republic of Croatia, in which she was responsible for the management and implementation of the European Social Fund and other EU instruments aiming at human resources development. And for the last 20 years, her professional interests are human rights and gender equality, social policy and employment, with particular accent to the labour market qualities. A very warm welcome, Katarina.
Thank you very much, and also good afternoon to everyone, we are all in the almost same time zone, so indeed it is a late afternoon. Greetings from Brussels. It's raining as usual, so nobody is missing anything from Brussels, and I wish I could have been with you in Vienna today, but there are so many things going on, also very relevant for persons with disabilities. And if I can give you fresh news, that is the one that, as you know very well, some of you are familiar with our European Disability Card, which we have managed to successfully agree with the co-legislators just a couple of days ago. And today we have a green light for the political consensus, which is called the general approach within our member states, for extending the disability card to the third country nationals. So this way we are covering all the citizens who are in the EU, and I modestly have to say it's a really big success for the whole disability community. So to go back to the topic, it is also a pleasure to see familiar faces, and I was listening very careful what Jesus was reflecting. And Jesus, you do have some big data and many information, and I try to write down some figures which are really impressive. And we, I would not dare to say, have just started, but AccessibleEU still has a long way to go, but still, even now, you have such a impressive results. Why are we doing all of this? It's quite a simple reply, because we as a union, we are fully anchored into the values of equality, social fairness, freedom, democracy, and human rights. Our treaty is very strong. Our Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, they are the basis to combat all the forms of discrimination and establishing equality as a key cornerstone of EU legislation and the policies. During the last decades, we have seen a number of EU rules that have been adopted in a different areas to make the EU more accessible, to make it more equal, and to eliminate discrimination of persons with disabilities in all the senses, I would dare to say. In this opening session, I will focus on accessibility legislation, and in particular, our big success, which is European Accessibility Act, while during the panel, I will present you the rest, the other aspects and the state of play on non-discrimination legislation. So, the EU strategy for the rights of persons with disabilities, which is implemented since 2021 and will be implemented until 2030, places the utmost importance on accessibility. And we see in the strategy, we see the accessibility as the enabler of the rights and also prerequisite for the full participation of persons with disabilities on equal basis with others. And this is the beginning and the start of our strategy. A number of rules are in place in different areas. For example, electronic communications that have been put in place even before 2021, the audiovisual media services, the website and mobile application, applications of public sector bodies, the copyright legislations, and some aspects of the passenger rights. And just to let you know that we are also in the process of the revision of the passenger rights in the EU. And also, we do believe that by European Disability Card, we will additionally contribute to the improvement of persons with disabilities when moving or traveling. So, the European Accessibility Act has been adopted almost 5 years ago, in 2019. And this is an act that sets the EU-wide functional accessibility requirements for certain important products and also important services. These are all relevant for daily lives of persons with disabilities, but also we always emphasize some other cohorts of the society, like elderlies, for example. And these include computers, it includes something that we use all the time, like smartphones, the banking services. The Accessibility Act also includes the e-commerce, e-books, and some elements of transport services. And those of you who have been following us closely remember the difficult negotiations we had in order to include, for example, transport services, and how we have managed to preserve the level of ambition, but still some aspects are missing in the Accessibility Act, which now we are trying to address with other acts and also trying to improve it in the everyday activities. On some aspects that are relevant for persons with disabilities, like for example, the built environment, the European Accessibility Act leaves member states options as to transposition, and the Commission encourages them all the time to be ambitious, to strive for more and really go for as much as possible. The accessibility requirements can be used to render the operational other pieces of the EU legislation that contains some provisions on dealing with accessibility. For example, the public procurement, which is very important for all of us. The deadline for EU member states to transpose, and transposition is a period after the adoption of an act until it has to be in place in the national legislations. This deadline was 28th of June 2022, and at this moment we are verifying if the member states have communicated all national transposition members, and also if these measures are fully and correctly incorporated in the legal system, and also that they incorporate the provisions of the Accessibility Act into national 28th of June 2025. To some, it might seem like a long period, but it's really just around the corner, and the member states are really trying to address all the remaining issues. Like, I can tell you that by now we do have the information about the transposition in almost all member states. In some member states, we have already identified some gaps which we are trying to address. But if the member states would not address the remaining gaps, or if some elements would be missing, then we have a special procedure how to address this issue. And maybe just for your info, the member states were not left alone during the transposition period. We have provided the necessary support. We have organized a network of the contact points on the transposition of the European Accessibility Act, and we tried to steer the member states toward a common understanding of the provisions of the Act. Also, in order to support the implementation of the European Accessibility Act, the Commission issued a new standardization request to the European standardization organizations to revise the standards that are currently in place in the areas of built environment and ICT, and also on the design for all approach. And also we have asked to develop new standards on the accessibility of non-digital information related to products, of support services related to products and services, and on the accessibility and interoperability of emergency communication, because the emergency number 112 is also part of the Accessibility Act, and therefore it was necessary to ask for this standard also to be developed. And then lastly, but I just want to reiterate the importance of the AccessibleEU. What started as an inspiration by many, I would dare to say, and was included as one of the seven flagships in the EU strategy for the rights of the persons with disabilities, indeed became our reality last year. So far, I have only words of superlatives and positive motions for the work of the AccessibleEU. It is really so engaging. It has so many activities, and Jesus elaborated it so nicely about how all the experts, either at the national authorities or the civil society or the accessibility experts, are working together in order to really create this community of practice. And the only thing that I can say, that the Commission is of course absolutely committed to full implementation of the AccessibleEU, and I'm pretty sure that very soon we will be discussing about the future of the AccessibleEU, because towards the end of this year we will be addressing and in a way reflecting on how the let's say first third or almost first half of the strategy was implemented, what do we consider as a positive elements and positive moves and movements when it comes to the rights of the persons with disabilities, and what are the next activities for the next 5 years, so from 2025 until 2030, having also in mind that this Commission and this mandate of the European Parliament are coming to the end, and we will have a new Commission and a new Parliament in the EU. And also this is an opportunity to see how we want to move forward, what do we want to achieve further, and what is that persons with disabilities really need, and how we can address this issue. So with this, I would close, and I see that we are perfectly on time. So thank you very much, and looking forward to continue the discussion in the panel.
Thank you very much, Natasha, for those valuable
Thank you. The code is very important to control the attendance, because we have to know, we need to know what people attendance the event, and to share information and to build this community of practices. So I encourage all of you to scan the QR and put your data in there, because it's important for us. This is the purpose of the QR.
Thank you for the explanation. I want to invite everybody to register. So we are now going on to the discussion about the disability legislation. And well, it's very interesting to be part of this discussion today for me, because in Austria,
say in the United States, the disability rights community is the key foundation for all the various disability legislation that has come through. The people with disabilities were in the forefront in the writing of the language, in being activated to protest, grassroots efforts, everything to make sure that those legislation came into play. One of the first legislation that was passed that a lot of people are probably not aware about is called the Architectural Barriers Act. It was passed in 1968. This legislation came into play because there was a staffer on the Hill, when I say the Hill, in Congress, who was not able to access federal buildings. So his boss, the congressman for his office, said we need to pass a legislation to make sure all federal buildings and federal spaces need to be accessible. That's a piece of legislation that has been in the books since 1968. You often don't hear about it, but that is the initial path to ensuring accessible built environment. So in 1968, the Architecture Barriers Act got passed, but soon after it was passed, Congress realized just by having a legislation or law that has been passed doesn't necessarily mean you can enforce it or implement it because you don't have the appropriate standards to make sure how do you ensure accessibility of a built environment. So in 1973, under the Rehabilitation Act, the U.S. Access Board was created to write those technical standards to make sure when we talk about accessibility of the built environment, what does those standards should consist of? How do you evaluate accessibility? So the U.S. Access Board's first charge was to create those built environment standards for the federal spaces, which was created in 1973. So we've been in existence for a little over 50 years now as a federal agency. Just give a little quick background about us as a federal agency. And when just so that you understand, when I say a federal agency or a federal department, it's equivalent to what other countries might refer to as ministries. So we are an independent federal agency that's directly under the White House. It's a small federal agency, but its task is to ensure the design of accessible standards for the built environment, for public transit, for information communication technology, medical diagnostic equipment, and various different areas that interest our population. We've been working on all these different standards for the last 50 years, and Congress keeps adding different authorities to the U.S. Access Board, so we write those technical standards. What makes us unique is we write the technical standards, so we have the technical expertise to write these technical standards, but we do not enforce these standards. We have only one enforcement authority, which is to ensure federal spaces are accessible. So anything to do with the federal government, the physical access to those spaces are accessible. The way the legislation in the U.S. worked with all these different authorities that has come through since the first, since the Architectural Barriers Act, or the ADA or the Rehabilitation Act, or the Affordable Care Act, the enforcement of all these different standards that we write is done by the different federal departments, such as maybe the Department of Justice, who is the legal arm of the federal government, or Department of Transportation when it comes to the transit, Health and Human Services when it comes to anything to do with healthcare. That's how it's structured, so that you have an independent agency such as the Access Board who can create the standards, but the enforcement agency adopts the standards that we write and enforces those standards. Now, it sounds simple. Its implementation of that is always not the easiest approach. There is barriers when it comes to how implementation and enforcement happens. As our agency, now structured. We have a 25-member board and a staff of 30 people. So we're not big by any means, but the 25-member board has a lot of influence, primarily because how it's structured. So we have 13 members who are appointed by the president. So the president of the United States appoints 13 public members from the public who have a background in accessibility or are people with disabilities. And the other 12 are senior level political appointees from 12 federal departments. So we have a senior level appointee from the Department of Justice, so the Assistant Attorney General from the Department of Justice, the Assistant Secretary from the Department of Transportation, Housing and Urban Development, Health and Human Services, fairly senior level. What that does is when accessibility standards are created, we have direct access to the senior level of these enforcing federal agencies to ensure that they adopt our federal standards and they are incorporated into the regulation that their federal department is working on. So that structure has proven to be very successful for us, but there has always been, you know, obstacles always do come up, you know, when you're working with the government as bureaucracy and things do take time. Working on regulation, from the time a regulation is created to the time it's adopted and enforced, there's usually a lapse in time. And especially in the space of IT, ICT, those could give a huge, there could be a huge gap in some of this enforcement mechanisms. So while we have had a lot of success in the different areas that I touched on, like the built environment, ICT, transit, we still are behind on the curve when it comes to things like ICT, you know, where we are having conversation about artificial intelligence, but there's nothing really in the books when it comes to how do you regulate artificial intelligence. We haven't even started to scratch the surface on how to work on that. And the technology is moving fast. So that's where the weakness comes, is it takes time to regulate and put these regulations in place. And then on top of that, how do we make sure these regulations that are put in place are successful? One thing that we have done successfully as a federal agency and other, not just the U.S. Access Board, but also the other federal departments and agency, is the interactions that we have with the community. That's not just the disability community, but also the industry, the technical groups out there, the different groups that have a direct interest, or different stakeholders, cities and towns, who need to understand these regulations, but also for us to learn from these different stakeholders. We often hold town halls, meetings, public hearings with all these different stakeholders, so we learn of the different barriers that exist. Those public hearings that we hold has a significant impact in what the regulation shapes up to be. The different processes that goes in the regulatory process also have a direct impact because there's a huge importance given to public comments. So the public weighs in on what the draft regulation looks like through the different levels, through the different processes. This is where the disability community has a significant impact on how they want to shape what the regulation is going to look like. Now, every accessibility regulation is not perfect. We have to revise it over different periods of time so that it addresses the changes coming up. But it has made a significant difference in how accessibility is seen around the United States. And we still have a long ways to go. By no means U.S. is where it needs to be. It has a long ways to go. When I immigrated to the U.S. in 1995, I took it all for granted because I did not have access to any of those accessibilities when I was living in Dubai. That's where I grew up. And when I came to the U.S., I thought this is perfect. Well, you know, we learned soon that it was a start to a lot of barriers that still exist.
So let's start with the main purpose of the equal rights for persons with disabilities law in Israel is to ensure that all people with disabilities in Israel are able to enjoy equal rights and opportunities and live full and meaningful lives. The equal rights law established that people with disabilities have the right to participate in all aspects of society, including the right to work, to education, to transportation, and to have equal access to all public places and services. But as everyone knows, legislation alone is not enough. It is the implementation, the transformation of words into actions that bring about the actual real change. An important aspect of the law is the notion that in order to lead this change, there is a need for effective enforcement. Otherwise, the law is just a written manuscript. So, to this end, the initial legislation of the law includes a set of enforcement powers that are civil powers, enforcement powers, as well as administrative slash criminal enforcement powers. While civil enforcement powers are given to both the civilian population and to the Commission for Equal Rights of Persons with Disability, and administrative slash criminal were given only to the Commission, which is government agencies that I'm heading for the past 2.5 years, that established by the Equal Rights for Persons with Disabilities Law in 1998, and is responsible for promoting equal rights of persons with disabilities, as well as fighting discrimination and exclusion. The Commission also ensures that all public places, facilities, and services are accessible to people with disabilities. When the law was initially passed, given the perception that the entire notion in Israel of accessibility was still at its onset and required implementation among those obligated to provide accessibility, the gradual and measured enforcement procedures were implemented. Accordingly, it was determined that once a violation of the law is found, the violator would receive an administrative warrant ordering them to fix the violation within a reasonable time frame. Only in the event in which the violation is not fixed within the given time frame, a criminal procedure would be initiated. The practical result of this old enforcement tool was lack of effective enforcement of accessibility provisions, as there is just no sufficient incentive and motivation for violators of accessibility to fix the violation before the initial enforcement actions were executed by the Commission. In addition, there were claims, right claims, some of which having a lot of truth to them regarding the inadequacy, the lack of balance between the powerful criminal measures and the violations, which are regulatory in their nature, and in most cases stem from economic reasons and practical reasons, and no intention to actually discriminate. Now, Amendment 23 to the Equal Rights of Persons with Disabilities Law, which was passed in the Knesset Parliament in Israel, intends to provide a solution to the problem, to this very, very problem of ineffective accessibility enforcement. Amendment 23 stipulates that when a violation of accessibility provision is found on the part of an obligated party, the Commission would have the authority to take 3 different administrative measures, with a decision on which specific measure would be taken only after a process of inspection and investigation. The purpose of the inspections are to gather various information, such as the economic capacity of the obligated party, actions taken by the obligated party to fulfill their accessibility obligations, and of course, the obligated party's own claim with regard to the specific violation. After these inspections, according to this Amendment 23, the 3 administrative measures available to the Commission are the authority to impose a fix the violation and avoid further penalty along with depositing a collateral. The choice of a specific measure taken would be in accordance to specific conditions detailed in the legislation that was passed and by a written administrative order given by the commissioner. The guiding principle in choosing between the different enforcement. Turnover of less than a certain annual threshold, specifically 20 million Israeli shekels, approximately $6 million, would pay lower fines in the first 4 years after the commencement of the implementation of the legislation, would receive only an administrative notice for the first violation, of course. This is based on the presumption that these entities are less aware accessibility applications under the law, as well as the idea to implement of the legislation gradually. The second parameter is that if a violation of an obligation is a result of a reliance on misinformation provided by a professional accessibility expert that was employed by the obligated party, either a business entity or a government entity, then the obligated party receive only an administrative notice, while in this case, the obligated party would still be obligated to fix the violation, but a financial sanction would be waived on the account that the obligated party acted in good faith based on professional advice. Expectedly, the successful process of passing this Amendment 23 was a result of some major efforts, both in front and behind the scenes, as well as dealing with numerous objections from both public sector and private sector obligated parties. These objections reflected well the magnitude of the upcoming change expected, and these objections also reflected well the big change that was expected to take place, despite that fact that the essential requirements to comply with accessibility provisions have not changed following the legislation. The transition to administrative enforcement, which will undoubtedly be faster, more efficient, and carry with it financial sanctions, will contribute to the understanding that the accessibility obligations are indeed present and should be taken seriously and be complied with. The main parties that were involved in the formulation of this amendment, besides us, the Commission, were various NGOs who represent interests of persons with disabilities, as well as representatives from the private and public sector. Now, in addition to intensive internal preparatory measures for the commencement of this implementation of the new legislation, the Commission keeps working to improve the obligated parties' understanding of their obligations. We are doing this through several broad public campaigns and using various promotional tools, as well as intensive outreach activities. Furthermore, we are developing new technological means to help obligated parties understand and comply as soon as possible with the new amendment. Meanwhile, we are constantly working on measures to evaluate the success of this legislation. So, to sum up, Amendment 23 to the Equal Rights of Persons with Disabilities Law in Israel was sparked by the inadequate and inefficient enforcement of accessibility in Israel in the recent decades. The objective of the new legislation is to encourage obligated parties to comply with accessibility requirements conceptual and practical change in accessibility and accessibility enforcement in Israel, moving from a phase of learning and understanding the accessibility obligations and requirements to a new phase in which accessibility becomes the fundamental aspect of every service in every place. We do believe that the important issue of effective enforcement is shared by all policymakers in all places and all areas of life. We are constantly searching for additional new ways to enhance awareness of the needs of people with disabilities and of the legal obligations that stem from those needs. This new legislation presents a new and genuine approach in line with the general direction the Israeli government is currently promoting and pursuing with regard to many other regulations. An approach of administrative enforcement, legal tools rather than criminal ones. And in this particular case, the regulations of accessibility enforcement. I'll be happy to take any question.
Thank you so much. Are there any questions already? Well, it's very interesting that you give us more insight on the claim for removal, because this is something in Austria which is kind of an open wound, because under the Federal Disability Equality Law, we don't have yet such a thing as a claim for removal, which makes it quite hard for people with disability to get to their rights, because the economic situation of the plaintiff's situation is under consideration. So if a company or a restaurant, for instance, says it's financially not in the situation to make those accessibility standards available to the people, the financial situation is taken into consideration, and for that there is no claim for removal, which is really, really frustrating for people with disabilities that there is no such thing as a claim for removal. So, Katrina, you mentioned before that there is a network to support the member states, and what I would like to ask you, one thing that mentioned from Dan was the need of public campaigns. So can you tell us a little bit more what is planned concerning public campaigns, like a guideline that the member states can use for the implementation of the Accessibility Act? Could you emphasize on that?
Yes, of course. Well, first of all, I think it's quite late, and we have bombarded the participants with so many legal aspects, legal rights, rules, and I just hope that audience is still interested in our panel. So that's the first point I would like to make, and also congratulations for being with us, even if it's 6 p.m. Second of all, on your topic, on the question, like concretely speaking about, for example, campaigns, we have recently finalized a big campaign, which was called Together for Rights. This campaign was done EU member states wide, and it was a campaign about the different aspects relevant to persons with disabilities. One of them was independent living, or one of the aspects was the accessibility, the other was inclusive education. We covered all the aspects relevant to rights when it comes to the employee inclusion in the employment, etc. And I have to tell you that for the choice and for the way how we presented a campaign, it was not an easy decision, because we wanted to reach out to all the persons with disabilities, and we had developed a network of so-called disability champions, which were persons with disabilities, all representing the different cohorts of persons with disabilities, with the same objective, to reach out and to make the disability topics much more, I would say, interesting and much more accessible for everyone, not only persons with disabilities, but also the policymakers and those who are dealing with the rights of persons with disabilities. If I can continue, Christina, would you like me to present the EU legal?
Yes, please.
So I'll try not to overkill with a number of information and stipulations that we have. So let me somehow structure next few minutes. I will first tell you about Employment Equality Directive, which is extremely important for all the persons with disabilities living in the EU, because it is the directive that lays down the general framework for combating discrimination, including on the grounds of disability in the area of employment and occupation. This directive prohibits direct and indirect discrimination. It is also covering the harassment and the instructions to discriminate based on a disability. The material scope of this directive includes, between the other aspects, the conditions for the access to employment, including the selection criteria and also the recruitment conditions. It speaks about the access to vocational guidance and training, employment, and also addresses the working conditions, including also dismissals and pay. And the Employment Equality Directive also requires employers to provide the reasonable accommodation to persons with disabilities. And this means that the employers shall take appropriate measures where needed, and in particular cases, to enable persons with disabilities to have the access to and participate in or advance in employment, or to undergo training, unless there is always the catch 21, and we say unless not to be disproportionate when it is sufficiently remedied by measures existing within the framework of the disability policy in the member states concerned. But all member states by now have correctly transposed this directive, because it is an old directive from 2000, but when you read it, it's very contemporary, and it's really overarching when it comes to the employment of persons with disabilities, and we extremely carefully monitor its application and implementation, and this is very important. For example, last year, 2 years ago, we launched the employment package for persons with disabilities, which is one of the elements of the EU strategy and one of the flagships of the EU strategy for the rights of the persons with disabilities. And within this package, we have a number of activities, a number of concrete deliverables, and one of them is the guide on reasonable accommodation, which is going to be issued quite soon and finalized quite soon, before the end of Q2, definitely, this year. And in this guide, we will provide a number of concrete examples how employers can secure the reasonable accommodation and what is to be understood as a reasonable accommodation. Then we have a very important proposal, so not the final text and not the final directive. It is proposal for the Equal Treatment Directive. It's a new legislative initiative, but not really new. Those of you who are from the EU and who have been following this topic for many years, you know that this directive was proposed already in 2008, and its objective is to extend the protection against discrimination based inter alia on disability in the area of social protection, including the social security and healthcare, education and also access to goods and services, including a very important topic for all the persons with disabilities, which is housing. The large majority of member states support this initiative. However, the legal base for this initiative, which legal base is derived from our treaty, requires unanimous approval of the member states, and within the past 16 years, there have been certain progress, but the member states could not agree on all the aspects and all the elements of this directive. Now the Belgian presidency, which is temporarily taking the role also of the presidency of the council, is has one additional attempt to see if this important directive could see the light of the day, but it's still to be seen if this is indeed going to happen or not. Then I spoke about European Disability Card and the parking this, but let me quickly remind you that we have reached, the co-legislators have reached the political agreement, which was blessed in the council side, and now we are waiting for the final steps so the two co-legislators could co-sign the European Disability Card and the parking card for persons with disabilities. We think it's a big step for all disability community, because with this card, first of all, it is going to be a harmonized European Disability Card and improved European parking card for persons with disabilities. And with this card, the card holders will be able to access the services with preferential treatment or special conditions under the same conditions and under the same terms offered to the citizens of that member state in which they are traveling for a short stay or visit. The card will be also applicable to all EU mobility programs, so whenever a student or an employee or somebody goes to Erasmus or Erasmus Plus in another member state for the duration, or some other, like for Horizon-led, etc., mobility programs, the card will be extended. And it means that we are making a unique system all across EU. And with the parking card, it means that the persons with disabilities can use the public parking spaces for persons with disabilities of their member states while visiting and traveling. And the biggest shift and the biggest change will be that persons with disabilities will not have to prove their status. They will just simply have to have the same rights when it comes to the access to services as the other EU citizens. So that's really, really a huge step forward, and I'm looking forward for the years to come and to see how this important directive will be implemented. There is also another very important directive that has also reached a political agreement in February, and that's the proposed reform of the equality bodies. And it is meant to ensure that EU anti-discrimination rules are applied and enforced more effectively. And because currently all member states are already required to set up national bodies to combat discrimination in the workplace and on the grounds on sex, yet the mandate and the competencies of these bodies vary from one country to another, and the new rules, which are agreed with the parliament, will establish so-called common EU-wide minimum requirements for equality bodies in a number of key areas, including the disability. But this also means, among the other elements, enhanced competencies and a legal requirement to be independent from external influence. Sorry. A requirement for sufficient resources and also increased powers to conduct inquiries and dispute resolution in discrimination cases. So very happy that this agreement has been made. Beside the Employment Equality Directive, we also do have five other equality directives in the different fields, like education or the more general. But with these proposals on the reform of the equality bodies, in principle, the same approach would be taken when it comes to the all occurrences of the possible discrimination. Well, to conclude, and I apologize if I was a bit too long, the EU has over the years developed indeed I would say important and substantive legislations which are supporting the full inclusion of persons with disabilities in the community. We believe that good legislation requires good implementation. So our future efforts will be towards monitoring the implementation and also helping the member states in the transposition, especially when it comes to the European Disability Card and but also all the other pieces of legislation. Thank you.
Thanks, Katarina. I would like to come back to the discourses when it comes to legislation, and I would like to ask Sachin and Dan, because in Austria the discourse is closely linked always to the question of financing, and it's especially when it comes to the claim, for example, we have a lot of discussions going on. And so, are you familiar with this thematic imbalance from your own countries, and how did you manage to navigate those discussions? Maybe then you could start.
Sure.
Sure.
Okay. So, we are very familiar and very aware of this so-called anomaly. And we are making, you know, a big change of conception when it comes to small entities or even minor, very, very small entities as opposed to large entities, business entities or government entities. And we do think that there should be a difference in ways of enforcement, in ways of dealing with different sizes and different capabilities of different entities. And this can be seen in the legislation, in the way we enforce the legislation, in obstacles that we put to ourselves as far as enforcement. But there still cannot be any argument to the fact that no matter what size and what capabilities of the entities, they should provide accessible environments and services. If an entity is very small and doesn't have significant resources or a
access. Now, the ADA has been out since 1990, but it has not been very clear how some of these pieces get addressed. So there's this back and forth of which higher education and how much in the higher education we need to enforce certain aspect of the accessibility. And this is where the comment period of how the public comments versus how the institution comments versus the industry comments, they all have different interests. And sometimes all entities don't get everything they want. People with disabilities may not get everything they want. Higher education may not get everything they want. So it's a debate that sometimes works for the best for the people with disabilities. And unfortunately, sometimes the people with disabilities don't get everything they want, and we have to kind of do the best we can. The minimum requirements will always be there. It's getting everything that we would desire to have. That's what takes the longest time. And usually, it's entities that are, I don't want to say low-income based, but those entities that doesn't have enough of a coverage to be able to accommodate those large accessibility requirements sometimes tend to get a pass. And we don't want entities to easily be given an exemption just because of one reason or the other. But for the most part, we have to take what's the best option we can get and then try for more enforcement on the next round of regulatory process. So it is a pretty drawn out approach that we have.
Thanks. Katerina, would you like to add something on that topic?
Well, it's quite important topic for us as well, but it has so many aspects that we have to pay attention to when it comes to, first of all, different stakeholders and the implementing the different parts of our legislation, and also securing sufficient funding for those. For example, let me just tell you that for example, for the European Disability Card, the access to services is based on the voluntary basis for service providers. So it's up to the service providers to decide if they want to have special conditions or preferential treatments for persons with disabilities. But we also asked the member states, and the member states have agreed that they should work towards and finding the means towards promoting and supporting the development, for example, of such a services. When it comes to the obligatory implementation of our legislation, then it is indeed at the member states to make sure that there are sufficient means for the implementation of the legislation. But when it comes, I don't want a broader discussion, but when it comes to the implementation of different policies relevant to the persons with disabilities, there is a lot of opportunity where EU itself, we are supporting it via funding. For example, with the European Social Fund, we finance a large number of activities relevant for all the aspects relevant to the persons with disabilities, from inclusion in the labor market, from inclusion in the skills, upskilling, reskilling, any such activity, to, for example, activities relevant to independent living and living in a community, or some other aspects that are not to mention the health aspect or some other also equally relevant for persons with disabilities. But as I said in the beginning, in the opening, we see everything we do, we take the accessibility lenses, and we have this, I would dare to say, almost a reflex to check everything against the disability mainstreaming and against the needs of the persons with disabilities. Thank you.
Thank you so much. We are almost ready to give the floor to the short presentation of the workshops tomorrow. Are there any questions you would like to ask?
website, it's quite easy to find it. And indeed, we are to resume the work of the contact points, because we see also the need, and we have been contacted by a number of the contact points as well, in order to see if additional help could be sorted out. Especially, I think, when it comes to the issue like e-books or some other aspects which have been somehow always of the top interest of our accessibility experts and the contact points. And yes, we are indeed planning to have a meeting still before the end of the Q1, so in one month to come. And I'm just very happy that you pointed out, because I believe you either are or are close to our contact. And please, if you have any issues that you would like that we put as the topics or that require further attention, we'll be also very happy to assist you. Thank you.
Thanks again. Is there another question?
Yes. Alexandra Nordmann here speaking. I have a question to the European Disability Card. So we heard it will enable access to culture and to services. We heard there is something to students. My point is that one of our four freedoms enjoyed by EU citizens is the free movement of workers, which includes the rights of movement and residence for workers, the rights of entry and residence for family members, and the right to work to another member state and be treated on equal footing with nationals of that member state. So my question is, when this European Disability Card will treat this access to employment and work across borders in the European Union? Because I don't see any evidence that this is planned for the near future. Thank you.
Do we collect some more? Or?
I think this has to be the last question, because we have to give the floor to the workshop presentations. So please.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Well, the essence of the European Disability Card is to facilitate free movement of persons with disabilities in accessing all services that do offer preferential treatment or special conditions in all member states during the period of short visits. And short visits are identified up to 3 months, because according to EU legislation, if the time is extended, if it is more than 3 months, then we fall under different rules and the different procedures. But the member states may decide to extend this period beyond 3 months. And let's see how the member states will embrace or not this opportunity. And for the mobility programs, during the duration of the full mobility programs. When it comes to the workers, we know that there are certain challenges related to the workforce. These challenges are mostly linked with either the change of residence or some other very specific aspects and or the request for additional or new verification of the disability, especially if there is a full change of residence and you fall under completely new rules. But I would dare to say the good news is that in the European Disability Card, the European Commission has been asked to review and assess if there are any remaining gaps in the access in the implementation of the free movement of persons with disabilities, and if we identify such a possible gaps, then we will be acting upon. As I told you, we are also at the time of the end of one commission, welcoming soon a new commission. We will be discussing a lot what is missing, but also we have this commitment, and we have taken this commitment to assess and to reflect on remaining challenges when it comes to the persons with disabilities. And then when it comes to the free movement in relation to work, there is a number of services and the rights that persons with disabilities can utilize even today, in accordance with, as I mentioned, other EU regulations. Thank you.
Thank you. So, Katarina, Jesus, Sachin, and Dan, thank you so much for your insights that you shared with us. And thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. And now I would like to move on to the workshops tomorrow taking place, and therefore ask the workshop leaders to present their workshop in 2 minutes. So I would ask to come forward. Workshop policies and standardization.
Okay. Not only maybe because they were born too early, also be actually for me the EASPD. Thomas is here representing the organization. And from my side, because the time is going to be a workshop on policies and standards, just to give you a hint, today at the very beginning of this session, presented the European Accessibility Act, and on the other hand, when Sachin from the U.S. Access Board was talking about the experience in the USA, he said that they had the legislation, but they had to create the U.S. Access Board to be able to develop standards to implement that legislation. So here in Europe, we had the same issue. We had the World Accessibility Directive, we have the European Accessibility Act, and we need standards to implement those policies in the real situations for businesses, for users, for persons with disabilities, for professionals. So I invite you to be part of that adventure. We will give you some keys tomorrow to check how to do that, and we will draft recommendations for the public administrations and for the standards organizations to try to improve or to speed up the process.
Thank you, Fernando. And to complement a little bit the focus on the standards, there would also be discussion over policies. And I think it was discussed at the beginning that actually accessibility is not complex. It's simple. I would tend to disagree. Accessibility is complicated. But at the same time, it's essential. It's really important that we make progress on it. And therefore, what we will be discussing tomorrow in the workshop is trying to make accessibility policies more accessible in some ways, bringing it down, bringing it back to the basics, focusing on how to engage with different stakeholders, how to engage with public authorities, how to lobby, who to speak to, and we go through that type of process to try and make accessibility policies more accessible. So join us.
Thank you.
The workshop will be at 10 tomorrow in M4. If you don't know where M4 is, it's downstairs, but in a corridor near that facade. So don't miss us.
Well, thank you so much. The second workshop is about transport. Gerald, could you please?
Thank you very much, Chair. The best workshop tomorrow morning is going to be on transport. Sorry, colleagues. As everybody knows, transport is essential for us to even get here, be it air travel, be it by marine, or be it by train, bus. So the best workshop tomorrow morning is in M6, covering what are the issues around accessibility, as Thomas said, is transport is another complex problem that we need to resolve over the next couple of years. So we'll talk about what are the problems, what are some of the solutions, and what are the next steps regarding particularly the standards, but also the work under EU Accessible Hub. So look forward to seeing you all at the BIS workshop. Did I say BIS workshop? BIS workshop tomorrow morning at room M6. Back to you, Jack.
Thank you so much. The workshop, Tourism and Built Environment, will present Camille.
Can you hear me? I'm a bit far from the mic. Okay, good. That's good. Good. So, yeah, now I decided the best one should be summers. On big environment and tourism, and tomorrow at M7 before I forget the room. I tend to forget at that time of the day. And yeah, we will discuss about, you know, big environment and why it's relevant to us. And you know, the AccessibleEU Resource Center has been launched to improve accessibility of the built environment, ICT, transport, standards, those things we already had, also from other workshops, with a number of coordinated actions. While the built environment is addressed as a separate target, there is a strong relationship between all of five, of course. There are still many significant architectural barriers affecting the freedom of movement for disabled people and others with specific access requirements. In Europe, in towns, in cities, in public spaces, building, in access to the natural environment, which is also important, and we all very often forget about it. I was asked before if I like mountains at some point today, and I said yes, but I never can go. So yeah, we need to discuss this stuff as well. So AccessibleEU is monitoring built environment policies and their implementation when it comes to accessibility legislation and standards. We aim to improving access to relevant knowledge and skills by professional, also architects, engineers, public procurement officers, and we are identifying and sharing good practices that may be clustered to all types of buildings and environments. So yeah, I will not speak much more, don't worry. I just put some notes because yeah, I need it. So accessibility is often seen as mistakenly as an additional cost, but actually, you know, we know that it's the opposite. When buildings and environments are designed correctly, following design for all or universal design, the principle space enhances architectural quality and ensures ease of use, higher quality, comfort, health, safety for all users over the lifetime, you know, of, and, you know, for everyone. Again, today at some workshop there was this discussion whether, you know, why we need to be so accessible and that it doesn't benefit only disabled people, but it benefits everyone. If you make a building with steps, some people are excluded. If you build a building with them, everyone is going. So my final point here is that follow Meet the Environment Workshop tomorrow on AccessibleEU and join our community of practice to keep in touch with our work. At the AccessibleEU Workshop, we will address many of these issues that were highlighted and show how accessibility for all can be achieved in Europe and with lessons that can be applied around the world.